But if I don't do what the Bible says, it's fruitless. It now just becomes a book. I can be a nurse, which I am, and read the PDR, which is a book full of medicines and tell you what they can't do and what they can do and counter actions and all that. That doesn't make me a better nurse. It makes me a well-read nurse. But what would happen if I read the PDR day in and day out, and then all of a sudden I have a patient that codes and stops breathing? That information's useless because I haven't exercised the knowledge that I got from it. As Christians, when was the last time you exercised the knowledge that you got from the Word? Reading it is one thing, doing it is another. I don't want to see a sermon, I want to be a sermon. You need to be and practice what you read. The Bible says, pray unceasingly. That means pray. The Bible says, help those in need. The Bible also says, you've never visited me in the prisons. How many of you have not visited someone else who you didn't even know them? Just visit them in the name of God. That's practicing what the Word says. That's exercising faithfulness. You see, faithfulness is using faith. Let me give you an example of faith. Faith is useless when you already know what you're doing. Let me say how flying works. I fly a hang glider. I've flown before, and my wife really doesn't want me to fly it. And there's an expression, going outside your envelope. Now, if you're flying, and you're doing a straight, steady flight, and you gradually bank, and you do the whole thing, and you land, and everything's smooth, you never went out of your envelope. You never tested anything. But let's say you get up there, and they're saying, let's do some stalls. That's when the airplane goes up, and all of a sudden, the propeller just starts going clunk, 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 and you realize you're about 4,000 feet in the air, and the plane falls. And what it does, it will just fall, it will go down, and it picks up. Now, that's not outside the aircraft's envelope, that's outside of your envelope, because you're like, whoa, the motor's not working, I'm not going forward, I'm actually going down. You are now experiencing what? Faith in that aircraft, whether you like it or not. You're going to hold on to that seat. If you're flying the aircraft, you're going to hold on to that yoke like it's going to really help you, but you're going to hold on. When you're with the Bible, with the faith, the only way to use that faith is to go out of your envelope. You're not used to talking to people about Jesus. Trust God. Step out of your comfort zone and speak to somebody about Jesus. Faith will carry you through. The spiritual strength, God will guide you through. You need to start using the faith. Because you see, if you're used to speaking to people, it doesn't matter. You know, it's fine to talk about God to everybody you know that already believes in God. No one's going to say anything. But how about going out to somewhere where they might hit you, might run you over with a car? I remember the first time my ministry started here, I had a bass amp, and I had a CD player and a bass. And I got permission at 7-Eleven to play. Faith is when you're playing there, and this car drives up to you and puts its high beams and revs the engine. I was like, whoa. But I stayed there. Because I knew God wanted me there. Yes, I was scared. Yes, people stayed away from me because it was not a good thing that was going on. And then he finally left. What I'm trying to say is, in order to faith to work for you, to show God you trust him, step out of the envelope and let him guide you. Dude, you can do anything that you're comfortable with. God's saying, let me take you out of your comfort zone and take you to another place. It's like your job. If you do your job well every day and never do anything new, you're never going to get promoted. The people that get promoted step out of the box. They go further. They call up accounts or whatever it is, and the bosses notice them, and they trust them, and they get promoted. Well, God's the same way. He wants you to step out of that building, the church pew, and start doing what he has told you to do. He wants you to get spiritually healthy. And the only way is to exercise and a healthy diet. As I close here, what is a healthy diet? Now, here's where most patients have trouble. And I'm guilty of this. How many ever been to a hospital and the first place you go after you leave is McDonald's? You just get out of the hospital, you know you're ready, you get some food you know you're not supposed to eat. You were just in there because you ate food you weren't supposed to eat in the first place. You see, we need to have a spiritual diet. But what is a spiritual diet? Well, a diet is hard. And if you've been on a diet, you know, it's easy to say, I'm going on a diet and I'm going to stop doing this, stop doing that. And then you go, whew, I'll do that tomorrow. And then when tomorrow comes, you go, you know, that was in the middle of the week. Let me start on Monday. Yeah. Then when Monday comes, you say, well, it's not really cool because that was, and I can't gauge anything. Let me do it at the beginning of the month. As you do this, a whole 6 months to a year passes, and you're still trying to say how you're going to do it because you never changed what you were doing. In order to get spiritually healthy, you need to change something, and you need to look at your diet. So what is a spiritual diet? A spiritual diet is something that you see, something that you hear, and something you touch, and something that comes in and comes out of your mouth. Like other diets, they always say, get checked up first. How do you do that? You get on your knees and say, God, show me my weaknesses. Where am I weak? And God will speak to you. Now, if you get on your knees to pray and see where you're weak and you realize you can't pray more than 5 seconds, well, you already know one of your weaknesses. Right there, prayer. So, what do? You say, boy, I'm out of shape. I'm really out of shape here, guys. I'm able to bench a lot and run 5 miles real fast, but with God, boy, I'm out of shape. So, as you sit down, you flick on the TV, and you say, whoa, that's part of your diet. What are you watching? What do you take as entertainment? Do you take entertainment of people hurting themselves? People singing things that they're not supposed to be singing, profane, and laughing at the... For example, everyone heard of Faces of Death? It's a video or movies, and it watches people die. They die in different ways. Or how about 1,000 Ways to Die? That's the newest one that's on there. And you sit there, and you get entertained by someone else losing their life. That is not a good thing. You now have eaten the equivalent of 5 Whoppers and 2 Big Macs at a time. That's your first thing that you need to change and take out. Then you get in your car and you start listening to stuff and you realize, I just flipped over listening to a sermon to have to better myself. I'm just going to listen to how bad the world is all the time. And hey, Jerry Springer's pretty cool. Yeah, he got shows like that. And I'll listen about other people's problems. Now there is another 2 or 3 Whoppers that are going into your spiritual diet. The list can go on and on and on. You need to find out what is in your spiritual diet. Now, I'll be honest with you. Like any diet, it's going to be hard to go cold turkey. So, one of the things that I started to do myself is that I realized I used to laugh about the things I did in the past. We call them sin, how I did things. And now I'm laughing about it, and I realize I'm enjoying it, I'm reliving it. I am doing the same sin over and over. I'm not doing it physically, but I'm doing it in my mind. So, that's another couple of Whoppers. So what I started to do is I said to myself, I'm going to stop talking about the things that I did wrong to people, You know, people say, oh, when I was a kid, I vandalized his car, ha, 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 ha. I'm talking about things like that. We can't just live on doing that. Change your diet. Look at what would God say about what you do? You gotta, and it's easy to remember. Let me clean up what I see. Because what you eat, what you see, and what you hear says what's in here. Any mother knows. How a child grows up is how it's going to live. How you practice the game is how you play the game, whether you like it or not. Garbage in, garbage out. I could go all day on saying all these things, but it's a fact of life. We need to control what is coming in so we can control what is going out. And what is going out, if it pleases God, He's going to be there. So when you get in that car accident and you call God, next thing you know, He's standing there. I remember as I get ready to close here, I already said that already, so I'm getting ready to really close. I remember I was in Burger King and I did the stupidest thing. I know people here have done it, I'm not going to admit it. I backed up without looking. And I glanced. I think I glanced. And I backed up. Thank the Lord I wasn't going fast. I backed out and boom! I said, oh boy. Now, I'll let you give you a little history on that. I was sent out from work to pick up lunch. I was still on the clock. And my wife is freaking out right now because she doesn't know about it. But anyway, I was sitting there. I said, oh boy. You know what the first thing I did? Because I was changing my spiritual diet, I started saying, thank you, God. I'm okay, thanks. And I started getting happy. I said, God, you're cool. That's how I said it. God, you're cool. You know, whatever's happening, I'm not worried about it. You're in charge. And I got out actually happy. I wouldn't expect I'd get out happy. As I get out, I see this man get out of this truck. He was a good-sized man. I'm glad I was happy with God because I don't think He was happy with me. Then I saw a boy come out, and he was yelling at the boy, look what you did. You didn't look where you were going, and you hit this man. And I told him, sir, it's okay. And he said, there's no damage because it was really light. I said, sir, don't worry about it. What is done, and it's okay. And he started yelling, see, you're lucky he was a good guy and he got in the car and drove off. But God took care of that situation. Could have been someone holding their neck with a strap, you know, going to sue me and everything. See, I depended on God. I had faith in God. And He took care of that. And also I learned to look behind me before I back out. Especially in Burger King. But what I'm trying to say here is that we look at the Word. Are you spiritually healthy today? Not spiritually okay. Spiritually healthy. Look at what you're eating spiritually. Look what you're feeding yourself. And look what you're feeding somebody else. We can be a wonderful Christian, get cut off in the highway and start screaming obscenities at somebody. See, many good Christians flip somebody off on the road. I hate to say it happens. But you have to ask yourself, how spiritually healthy was that man or woman? And the first step, when you see something like that, don't condemn, start praying for them. Start praying for yourself. Today, as I close, I'm just saying, I ask you this question. Is your spiritual diet all fat and carbs, or is it healthy? Just ask yourself that today. When you leave here, what's your diet like? And if you change your diet, your life will change, as well as physically and spiritually. Because God affects both the body and the spirit. Praise God.